Hi everyone, welcome to the basics lecture on genetics beyond Mendel's simple dominance. We talked in our last video about simple dominance, where the heterozygote shows the trait of the dominant homozygous organism. But what's going on when a red snapdragon is crossed with a white snapdragon and the offspring are all pink? The definition of incomplete dominance is that the phenotype of the heterozygote is intermediate to that of the parents, but this doesn't explain the biology behind the system. So let's take a look at that. The red color in snapdragon flowers is also due to an anthocyanin pigment, but this one looks red. The enzyme gene necessary for making the pigment is produced by the CR allele. The CW version of the gene contains a mutation, so it does not produce a working enzyme and no working anthocyanin is produced. So far, this should look familiar, but in incomplete dominance, there's a difference in the heterozygote. If a snapdragon plant has two copies of the working CR allele, it makes lots of red anthocyanin and the flower is red. If a snapdragon plant has two copies of the mutant allele, it makes no red anthocyanin and the flower is white. If a snapdragon is heterozygous, it makes a small amount of the pigment because it has a small amount of the enzyme, and the flower is pink. Codominance is often confused with incomplete dominance, but they're actually quite different. Let's look at codominance in blood type. There are three different alleles in the ABO blood type gene. In the A allele, the gene codes for a protein that adds one type of carbohydrate to the membrane of a red blood cell. The B allele has a mutation so that it codes for a different protein that adds a slightly different type of carbohydrate to the membrane of the red blood cell. And the I allele has a mutation that prevents any working protein from being made, so its red blood cells do not contain any carbohydrate in their membrane. In codominance, both phenotypes are expressed in the heterozygote. If both A and B alleles are present in the individual, then both proteins are made, so both carbohydrates are found on the red blood cell, here and here. The ABO blood system is also an example of simple dominance because the I allele is recessive and hidden if there is a working allele present, like A or B. Blood types are named based on the visible phenotypes. Blood type A has genotype of AA or AI. Blood type B has genotype of BB or BI. Blood type AB requires the genotype AB, and blood type O requires the genotype II. Can you find three cases of simple dominance and recessiveness and one case of codominance shown here? Blood type is also an example of multiple alleles. Did you notice there were three different alleles for the blood type here? Any single person can only have two alleles because they have only two chromosomes 19. So no one person can have all three alleles, but a population of individuals, like students in a class, can have all three. So here are some sample students. Do you see that a population can have more than two alleles, even though an individual can only have two? Some genes actually have dozens and dozens of alleles, all based on different mutations in their DNA. Now that you realize many alleles code for non-functional proteins, you'll be better able to understand epistasis. The example in your book is coat color in Labrador retrievers, so here's some puppies for you to look at. We use this cartoon of a cell type associated with the fur growth in the skin of dogs. The melanocyte cell produces pigment molecules, shown here, that include melanin. Melanin is packaged in a vesicle called a melanosome, and the melanosome then fuses with the membrane of the melanocyte, and the pigment is deposited in the hair cell up above. the gene associated with hair color are actually two different genes, the E gene and the B gene, and they're found in the nucleus of the cell. The B gene codes for a transporter that transports melanin into melanocytes for delivery to the hair follicle cells. This gene has two alleles. The big B allele produces strong transporter proteins, shown here, which can add a lot of melanin to the melanosome, which when delivered to the hair cell, makes the hair cells very dark and show as a black lab. The little B allele produces a less capable transporter. I've shown it here as smaller. This is able to add less melanin to the melanosome and to the hair cell, so the dog has a lighter brown, and it's called chocolate. What do you think will happen if the dog is a heterozygote? Well, since half the transporters are strong and half are weak, it's still able to add a lot of melanin to the hair cells, and the dog will be black. So the B gene is an example of simple dominance. So far, we've made a black dog and a brown dog. Let's talk about epistasis now. A second set of genes is important for coat color in Labradors. The E gene is found on a different chromosome, and it codes for a G protein coupled receptor, shown here, that's placed in the surface of the melanocyte. A hormone in the blood binds to the receptor, and this triggers the activation of a transcription factor that activates the B gene, which is then turned on and makes the melanin transport. Okay, so the E gene codes for the transporter and the B gene codes for the receptor, and the B gene codes for the transporter. If the dog has at least one working big E allele, then it's able to make the needed receptors. This allows the signal to bind to the receptor, the transcription factor is turned on, the transporters are synthesized, and the melanin is deposited in the melanosomes. The amount of melanin will be determined by what the genotype of the big B allele is. If, however, the dog is homozygous recessive for E, it has no working alleles that are able to code for the receptor protein. When the receptor is missing, the ligand can't bind, it can't signal the cell, there won't be any turning on, the transcription factor won't work. Without the transcription factor, the B gene won't be turned on, and the transporters disappear. And without transporters, no melanin can be deposited in the melanosome or in the hair cell. This means the dog will be white or light yellow. Because the E gene controls whether or not the B gene has had effect on phenotype, E is considered epistatic to B. Next, let's go over pleiotropy. In pleiotropy, a gene has multiple phenotypic effects. For instance, many cats are born with both blue eyes and deafness, and this is due to a single mutation. On chromosome 8 in cats, a gene codes for a protein that turns on the development of cells in the eye, where the gene adds pigment, to a cell layer called the tapetum lucidum. The same protein activates the development of cells in the inner ear. If there's a mutation in the pigment gene that prevents the protein from being made, then there'll be no pigment added to the cell layer in the eye, so the eyes of the cat are a low pigment blue. And also the inner ear does not develop correctly so that the cat will be deaf. This gene, therefore, has pleiotropic or multiple effects on phenotypes. Lastly, let's talk about polygenic inheritance. Many phenotypic traits are not simply binary but have a range of values, and human skin color is an example. One reason that many phenotypes are possible is that many genes with different alleles code for this single trait. This is called polygenic inheritance. You don't have to remember the gene names or the effects shown here, but you should get a sense that many different parts of the cell work together to add pigment to the skin. One gene activates a growth hormone to make pigment cells. Another gene codes for a molecule that blocks a receptor, preventing the cell from making pigment. And a third gene codes for a transporter in the Golgi membrane that's important for pigment formation. All three of these genes have different alleles, and all of these working together can affect final skin color. And there's even more genes than this that are involved. To summarize then, Mendel got lucky. He picked traits that only showed simple dominance. Actual genetics has proven to be more complex and more interesting than just pea plants. This completes our basics video today. Thanks for watching.